A small intro about me. This is Akhil from IEEE Hyderabad section, XCOM member, and also emerging tech fellow in Government of Telangana IT department. So I would like to tell about this webinar in a short brief. So the SmartBridge is an edtech startup in Hyderabad, where it has been listed in many places and also being tremendous in Government of Telangana as well. In giving AI webinar series and a lot of webinar series for that Telangana satellite networks and many places. So I wanted like that richness of talent to help all the people out there in IEEE as well. That's the reason we have brought SmartBridge to this now. And Sagar sir, can you come down and speak some words regarding IEEE Hyderabad section and Computer Society on what we are doing and all?
Yeah, Akhil, thank you. Morning, guys. Thank you for joining one more exciting webinar during this lockdown period. This month has been very encouraging because we started this all webinars as we can't do physical events, you know. And we are trying to come up with a lot of different topics, getting deviated, getting away from regular kind of things. And today we have IEEE around, as all you know, 400,000 plus professionals, and primarily giving their best to the humankind on the various technology front end innovations. So idea of all these webinars is to get into new technical era and also see that how you can practice whatever new digital learnings that we are going through, so that our aim and objective will be fulfilled. And today we have the team from SmartBridge. I would let them to speak about SmartBridge and what they are going to contribute for the society and what they mean about the transforming industry. And please feel free, there is a Q&A session will be there, but I would prefer all you put your questions in the chat window so that we can have interim breaks where we can take up the Q&A. And happy learning to all of you. Yeah, that's all from my side. Over to you, Akhil.
Thank you, sir. So for all those who miss, like Sagar sir is like chair of IEEE Computer Society, and he's also senior head in TCS. So it is always a great opportunity working with like very great professionals like you, sir. Thank you. And now we shall start that webinar very quickly. And right now we have Vishnu from SmartBridge. He's an excellent like corporate lead and alum of SNIST. And Vishnu, can you further start and tell about like Swati Garu, who is like
AI developer and all? So first of all, good morning, guys. Good morning to one and all student friends and respected academia professionals who are here on the Sunday morning to increase your academic curve and learning curve. So without any further delay, I would also like to thank IEEE Computer Society chapter and Hyderabad section to taking this initiative and organizing this this webinar on computer vision. We are more than privileged to be a part of this as a part of our webinar series, which we've been doing since the lockdown period has started. I think this is our eighth technological webinar series, and we've done starting with AI webinar series, which was a part of four webinar series. I hope everyone will be thrilled and excited to gain more knowledge on computer vision. And I hereby introduce you to our trainer of the day, Mrs. Swati, who's been an excellent professional with 4 years of experience in artificial intelligence. She's a lead AI developer at SmartBridge right now. She's been instrumental in developing project templates from real-time industry on AI for the remote summer internship program that we're currently doing. She's worked more than over 500 project templates. And over to you, Swati. I wish you a good session and wish you everyone a great knowledge sharing session, and I wish you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you, Vishnu. Yeah, good morning, everyone. So first of all, I just want to congratulate you because on this Sunday and this and quarantine time, you are choosing this time for learning new things. So I'm very happy for that. I just want to congratulate to all your people. And like today, we'll discuss about OpenCV. And most of you know actually what it is. And I'll just tell you in a basic way the normal people can also understand. And mostly today we'll discuss about more basics of like what OpenCV is and how can we like work with different kinds of techniques in OpenCV, like with images. So now we'll just start our session. So I'll just share you my screen.
And also before you proceed, guys, the format of this session is going to be like a webinar. You can already observe that your video and audio has been default muted off. The only means of communication for you to type in the Zoom chat or post your questions in Q&A option that you can see on your screens. We're going to have a Q&A at the end of the session once Swati is going to finish the explanation and demo of the computer vision. Then we're going to take up your questions. In the meantime, you can post your questions in Q&A or anything problem you have, you can post in the chat. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Vishnu. Yes, now you have understood the process, right? If you have any kind of queries, you can post in the Q&A and as well as you can post in the chat. Now we'll just start our session. Now today we are discussing about OpenCV. So I'll just give you a brief introduction about this OpenCV and I'll show you more about practical because this is OpenCV is a library, right? So in order to discuss, instead of discussing more about the theory, we can show the practical things, what we can do this. Okay. So now I just wanna ask you people, like among you, in your point of view, anyone heard about like what is actually OpenCV? At least do you know what it is in your terms? If you know that, just put me your answers to the chat. It's just a normal thing. If you know that, you can just mention the thing like what you know about an OpenCV. Like, am I audible? Hello?
Yeah, Swati, you are audible. Please go ahead.
Yeah, fine. Okay. Okay, done. Now we'll discuss. I'll just tell you on OpenCV. Actually, CV stands for computer vision. Now, why it is called as OpenCV means actually it is an open source. Okay, so open source computer vision. Okay, now we'll discuss about computer vision. Now, just tell me what here in your terms of vision. Now, if you want to say like computer vision is nothing but. So here it is a way of teaching an intelligence to the machines. So it is making a machines to, we are making a machines. So then it can see the things just like a human. Okay. So here we are making our systems and we are how we are able to see the particular thing. Now if I'm giving a particular image, now anyone can able to see my image, right? Now in this, if I'm giving to these image to you people, what you can give me an answer? You can able to give an answer. Can anyone give an answer? So it is having a group of people, right? It is having, you can able to see, I can able to, or you can able to recognize there are multiple people in this particular system, right? In this particular image. Similar way, our machine has to think in, our machine has to see in that way. It has to recognize the things and it has to recognize the content in that particular image, what it is having. Okay, so in simpler way, if I want to say computer vision, the computer vision is what allows a machine to see and process visual data just like a humans. So this computer vision will analyze the images and produce the useful information for us. So now we'll just show you that. Now how we can able to see through our eyes, right? Now how your system can able to see, how your system or machine can able to see with help of camera, right? And guys, I want some kind of response from you guys, because so that I can able to understand whether you are getting my point or not. So that please give some kind of responses, right? So now how we can able to see the surroundings, how can we able to see the world with our eyes, right? So our eyes will capture the particular movement, and you can able to see that, and you can able to analyze it, and you can able to recognize the things, right? Similar way here, how your computer can able to see with help of camera, right? So with help of camera only, the computer can able to see it, and it has to recognize the things. Now, if you comes to this, before going to this, so actually it was introduced in 1999. So it was introduced in 1999 by Intel. You know Intel, right? Intel company. It was introduced by Intel. So in 1999, but actually the first version introduced in 2000. So actually once Intel has introduced this later, you can able to see the one more company, that is Willow Garage. The Willow Garage is a one more company. Actually, it is a robotic based company. So actually after introduced Intel, Willow Garage has maintained this particular OpenCV. Okay, so and you can able to see, I think you people heard about, like, if you have a basic knowledge about robotics, like we are having a platform called, you are having an open source platform called ROS, Robotic Operating System. So those are developed by Willow Garage only. So those are maintained by Willow Garage people. And later it is maintained by ITSIS. So ITSIS is a one more company. It is maintained by the OpenCV. Again, that ITSIS is acquired by Intel itself. Okay. Now, if you comes to the applications, now we can see a number of applications with an OpenCV. So before that, actually, like this OpenCV has a different kinds of features. It will be work with the deep learning techniques. You know, I think you heard about deep learning techniques. It will support a lot of frameworks like TensorFlow. Have you people heard about this word TensorFlow, like PyTorch and Caffe model? Those are the different kinds of frameworks. Those are available in the deep learning. So with OpenCV, it is also supports those particular deep learning frameworks. So with this, both OpenCV and deep learning frameworks, we will have n number of applications which is currently running properly. Now, the first application you can see in the picture, right? So what it is, ANPR, it is saying ANPR, right? What ANPR? Can anyone guess what is this ANPR? If anyone know or no, if you don't know about that, just mention answer as no. I'm just telling one more time, this is like an interaction session. Please don't sit idle and just listen what I'm saying. Please interact with me so that I can able to understand whether you are getting the point or not. So can you know, anyone know what is this ANPR? You can put in a chat. What is your answer? Anyone? At least a guess? At least a guess? What is this ANPR?
They are answering as automatic number plate recognition. I think yes. Your chat is not being...
chat is not... unable to open it.
Yeah, they're answering as automatic number plate recognition.
Yes, that is absolutely correct. Automatic number plate recognition. Actually, in developed countries, it was already introduced. And the latest thing is in Telangana government also introducing this system. So automatic number plate recognition system. So now, this will be like, so you people know about this, right? Like, challenge generation in traffic situations, right? So there we can utilize this system like automatic number plate recognition system. So because like once it will just detect. So actually, so by using this, so if a person is violating any kind of rule, then automatically it will take the capturing of, actually it will be in a process of continuous streaming, right? So it will be capturing of that particular image, and even will have a, that particular, it will you will have a number, a registration number in that plate, right? So after recognizing that, we want to give the challan to those people, right? So in order to recognize that particular characters from that particular image, we are using a concept called OCR. I think you heard about this, Google OCR, optical character recognition. So Google OCR, with this OCR concept, we can able to detect the particular characters from that particular image. So with help of these two things, we can able to generate a challan to the people who are violating the traffic rules. So there are multiple areas we can use this particular system. This is one kind of application. Latestly, people are utilizing it. Now, if you comes to other kind of applications, like most of us are utilizing Facebook, right? Most of people are utilizing Facebook. So in Facebook, whenever we are posting one kind of image, for example, in that image, if your people like some people are there in it, right? So it will automatically, there is a concept called auto tagging in the Facebook, right? So if the people are already in your friends list, automatically it will identify those people and it will tag automatically their name in that particular image, right? So that is a one more example for, and that is a one more example for an open CV. So where in the Facebook we'll having a face recognition system, and it will have a auto tagging system. And also with help of OpenCV, we are having a multiple multiple applications like object detection and the gesture recognition and the face recognitions, where there are multiple applications with that we can able to with help of an OpenCV, and as well as including a deep learning techniques. Here in this image, you can able to see it is detecting this as an object and it is detecting this as a person, right? So it will detect the different things, different objects in that particular image. So this is, you know, one kind of object detection. So we are having n number of object detection algorithms in that, most of that we are in the back end, they are utilizing OpenCV. Now if you comes to our one more application, so I think nowadays we are using we are listening the words called self-driving cars, right? So Tesla has introduced that, right? So in the self-driving cars, the OpenCV plays an important role. So what is that actually? So you can see in this image, so that particular vehicle is having a camera. So it is detecting something. What is that? It is detecting a lanes on a road. So it is detecting a lane lies in which path we have to go. So in the self-driving cars, this OpenCV plays a major role where it will find out the lane lines in the road. So these are the one of the applications of OpenCV. Now if you if you consider this, there are a lot of applications in the OpenCV. We can there are a lot. So these, as of now, I'm discussing these kind of concept, but mostly used people. So before now, you people got an idea about actually what an OpenCV and where we can utilize this OpenCV, right? So for that, now how we can see an image, right? So how we can see an image like this, we'll see, right? It's a New York skyline. So now we will see the image in this way, right? Now how a system can see, or how a machine can see a particular image? Any answers? How computer sees an image? Now how it will see is, now if you consider about on a computer, so however we are seeing an image, we are seeing in terms of a picture, right? A graphical representation. So but your computer sees in a format of matrix. Your computer can see in terms of a matrix. I got some like answer from one person. So like they are saying it like a matrix. Yes. So the computer can see the particular image in terms of matrix. Okay. So now if you consider this, we'll see an in-depth of this. Now this computer can see your image in this way. So here I'm just taking, now if you consider about images, we are having the two things we'll discuss in the few minutes. So now if you consider, if it is a colored image, we'll have three colors. So if your color image will having RGB colors, right? Red, green, blue. You will have a RGB channel. So for your colored image, we'll having a 3 pixel values. Three kind of channels will be there. So those are RGB. So now you can see this is a three-dimensional. And one more thing, when you take a colored image, it will be represented in a format of three-dimensional array, okay, or matrix, okay. So now if you if your image is, suppose this image, like if you take a particular image will have a properties like height and width, right? So this height and width, so for example, this image is consisting of 180 by 180, for example. So then it will have a 180 rows and 180 columns, and it will have a, this is a colored image, right? So it will have a channel, so three channels. Now we'll see what is this two different kinds of images. Now if you consider about an images, we are having two different kinds of images. One is grayscale image, or we can call it as a black and white image, and other one is a colored image. So when you comes to the grayscale image, it will have only two kind of colors, that is either black or either white. We can have only both of these colors. So that kind of images we are call it as a grayscale image or black and white image. So this grayscale images will be represented in a two-dimension array, because for the grayscale images we'll have only one channel will be there. So we are having only one channel, so it will be represented in a format of 2D array. But when comes to a colored image will have a, now you can see this is my colored image and this is my black and white image. So when you comes to the colored image, it will have a three channels. Those are RGB. So red, green, and blue. We are having a three kind of colors will be there. And for that three kind of colors, we are having channels as a three. So for example, if you are having an, like 180 by 180, for a colored image, it will give you the like properties as a 180, comma 180, and comma 3. So 180, first 180 means height, width and height, and number of channels. Same thing if you can able to see for a grayscale image, it will just give 180, comma 180. So because it is only having one color, one will not be represented. Default it is one. So now we are just talking about the images, right? Why images means? Because your OpenCV so will be mainly focused on processing of your images. We are applying some kind of different processing techniques to the particular image. So by using this OpenCV. So in this, now if we are talking about the images, right? Now what is an image? We are talking about the images, right? We are having two kind of images, grayscale image, colored images like that. What actually an image? Can anyone guess what actually an image is? So image is nothing but a group of pixels, right? Yes, exactly. I got an answer called interconnected pixels, right? Right, exactly. Exactly. Good. A lot of people are giving an answer as a pixel values. Yes. Your image is nothing but it is having a group of pixels. So each and every pixel, like you will have a group of pixels is nothing but image, right? So for each, what is mean by pixel? Pixel is nothing but it will have an information about your image. So, and the intensity of that particular color values in that particular content in that particular image. So now if you take about the pixel, Yes, pixels are the, now if you consider, pixel is nothing but a one kind of number. So for each and every pixel, you will have a numbers. So this pixel will have a range of 2^8. You know, 2^8, right? 2^8 means we are having 256 values. Means your pixel value will be ranging from total 256 values, right? So your pixel values will be ranging from 0 to 255. So you, if you talk, if you taking any particular pixel, so that will have a range from 0 to 255 values only. So with that, whenever you are taking a particular image, it will be in a having a group of pixels. Each and every pixel will have a number, so that will be ranging from 0 to 255. Now, so we are talking about, like, if you are talking about grayscale, we are having only black and white images, right? But now if you're talking about colored images will use a concept called RGB, right? So if you are taking about now this, in this, if you look at this particular picture here, I'm having mostly some kind of like, if I'm talking about a high concentrator, like if I'm talking about highly colored images. So here I can able to recognize a three colors. One is black and other one is white and other one is yellow. Now, can anyone tell me what is the code of RGB code for black? Now here we are having black in the picture, right? So in this particular colored image, I'm having a color called black. So we are discussing, right, here colored images will use a concept called RGB values. So RGB, red, green and the blue. So now if I want to represent the black color in RGB, what is the color code for RGB? Can anyone? Yes, some people are like one member I have given 000. Yes, exactly. So if you are like, we are having RGB, right? We are having three kind of, we are having three. We have to represent in a three numbers, right? So if you mention 000, then that will be take it as a RGB values. Now I'll just show you one thing. So now I'm just using, you can able to see RGB color charts, right? So we can't remember all the color codes, right? Now if you can able to see here, this is a color code chart. You can able to see, now if I'm selecting a particular black color, now you can able to see it is 000. Like most of people have already mentioned, if you are taking a black color, then the RGB values are become 000. Then if I'm considering about white, so what is the value? So it is saying 255, 255, 255. If you are having full values of RGB, then you will get the color code called white. If you are getting full zero values for each and every RGB, then you will get the color code color called black. So similar way, you can also see for yellow, you can only see what is the color code we are having, 255, 255, zero. So these are the color codes which will be utilizing, which will be taken for the colored images. So it will generally will discuss, generally it will take the RGB values, but when you comes to OpenCV, so we are discussing about OpenCV, right? OpenCV will take this color codes as in a reverse way. It will take in a format of BGR codes. Now, generally, images will be taking in a format of, generally, images will consisting in a format of RGB, right? So, but here, OpenCV will take these color codes in a format of BGR. So, we'll see that in a practical session. Mostly, we'll chat that in a few more minutes. So, because this is a library, right? So, and this OpenCV actually originally developed in C++. You know, right? You people know, right? So, actually, OpenCV originally developed in C++, but it is having many kind of wrappers in a different kinds of languages. You know, wrapper, right? It is available in other kind of languages such as Python and Java and C#, like there are some kind of languages will be there. It can also support a lot of languages in a OpenCV. Okay. And also one more thing, we are saying, right, it is an open source, right? So open source means it is openly available for everyone. You can utilize it for a free, right? Open source for under the license, BSD license, right? So now this OpenCV will also be a cross platform. You know, right? What is cross platform? It can support in a different kinds of OSs, right? So it can support in a, like, you know, one application, if you take an application, when we call it as a cross platform. So this is a library, right? OpenCV is in a library. So it will also be a cross platform. It can support in a Windows, Linux systems, and as well as Mac. So it will also support in different kinds of OSs. And also it is having many number of, it is having wrappers in different kinds of languages, like based on which language you are more comfortable, then you can proceed with that particular, you can able to continue with that particular language. So, this is about image. Now we'll more discuss about, in terms of explaining the things in a theory way, but I just want to show you in a practical way so that you can more clearly understood about this particular thing. No need to go for any practical. If you want to practice, you can practice, but you can right now, as of now, you can listen my whatever I'm saying. Then later we'll send you the recordings, right? Later you can practice in your systems. Now, if I'm taking this particular, what is the image contents? Can anyone tell me? You can able to see one image, right? What is that image? So we are talking about images, right? Image is nothing but a group of pixels. It is having images, right? So this is a representation of an image. Now, how, you can see some kind of pattern in that particular picture, right? What is it? Actually, it is an 8, right? So when you take an 8, so we can see the image in this way. But how can computer can see like this? So it is having a group of pixel values. Okay, it is also a colored image so that you can able to see the color codes in that particular respected. Now you can able to see my screen, right? So this is a normal image. So in that image, it is represented the pattern. By seeing that pattern, we can able to recognize that it is a 8, right? Now you people can able to see my screen. Yes, my PPT. Yes, right. Some people are saying yes, some people are saying no. Whom should I consider? So, but I have shared my PPT screen only. Now just see once. Yes, right? Yes. So sorry for that. So actually you can able to see this particular image, right? So in this image, by seeing that you can able to recognize by seeing that particular pattern, you can able to say this is a particular 8, right? So as of now, like as we have learned something, so by seeing that we know the numbers and all, right? So by seeing this particular image, I can able to recognize by seeing this part and I can able to say this is 8, right? Now how you are, through our eyes, we can able to, we have learned numbers and by seeing that pattern, I can able to say this is an 8. But how your system can able to see? So your system can able to see your image in terms of pixels. Now you can see the pixel values, right? So your system can read this particular image in terms of pixel values. So So yes, right? So I hope you have got a brief idea about OpenCV, because we can't cover all the techniques and we can't cover all the things about the OpenCV, right? We are having only limited time. So I just want to go for a practical thing so that, because when you learn the thing, but when you are doing the practical, then you learn more. So for that, I'm just going for a practical. So if I want to go for a practical, what I need, I want to test for how can I read an image, how to perform, like how can I display and how can I do some kind of things to my image. So that I need to have a thing, right? So here I am very comfortable with the Python. So that's the reason we are going with the Python programming. I think like most of you people have an idea about Python, right? You people have an idea about Python or not? At least a basic idea? Yes. Yes, right? Yes. Because in these years, Python is mostly, most people are using a Python. So because it is having n number, it will be useful in a different kinds of domains, right? So now we'll just see a practical example for that. So for that, what we need, so we are going with the Python programming, right? So if I'm going in a Python programming, what I need to have some kind of IDE, right? So I need to have some kind of IDE. So for the Python, we'll have a different kinds of IDEs. So mostly people will use PyCharm and Anaconda. You know, Anaconda is a platform where we are having multiple kind of IDEs will be there. So people will use Anaconda, and some people will use a basic IDE called IDLE. So some people will use Visual Code, right? There are multiple IDEs will be there. As of now, I'm just having my Anaconda platform, so that I'm just utilizing a Jupyter notebook for that. So for that, I'm just starting my Jupyter notebook. Just wait for 2 minutes. So I'll just launch my Jupyter notebook. So anyone having an idea about Jupyter notebook? Have anyone worked with Jupyter? Yes. Okay. Some people are saying yes. There is no much difference. If you know about the Python programming, that will be enough for now. Now, everyone, can you able to see my Jupyter notebook? So I have opened from my browser. You can see it's a web application, right? It will be launched in a web page, right? So now, so initially, you know about Python, right? So Python is having many kind of internal libraries, right? So why people use mostly Python means one of the best thing in the Python is it is having huge number of libraries, right? So when you are having libraries, here I'm using Anaconda, right? So for today, we need to have two kind of libraries. One is an OpenCV, where an OpenCV, we are discussing about OpenCV, right? Along with an OpenCV library, we need to have one more library called NumPy. You people know about NumPy, right? NumPy stands for Numerical Python. So mostly will be used for a NumPy for in order to perform some kind of calculations and mathematical operations on a multi-dimensional array. So we will just utilize a NumPy. Okay. So for that we have to require two kind of libraries. One is OpenCV and other one is NumPy. So because here I'm utilizing Anaconda platform where I'm having an inbuilt library called NumPy. So there is no need to install the NumPy. And even though when you are installing OpenCV, automatically backend NumPy will be installed. Okay. So I'll just show you a command. So, you know, right hash will be used for commenting in your Python. So this, in order to install OpenCV in your Windows, we have to use the command called pip install opencv-python. Right? You know pip, right? So pip stands for Python package installer. So by using this pip, we can able to install the external libraries to our script files, right? So with help of, if you are having any kind of normal IDs, you can go with this pip install opencv-python even in Anaconda also. But if you are having Anaconda, there is a one more command. With help of Conda also, you can install. Same thing, Conda install opencv-python. You can also do this. So, but mostly the preferable way is pip install opencv-command. So when you install that particular, you can run this particular command in a command prompt, as well as you can able to install here also. Now, if you install here also, you can put a exclamatory symbol and you can install this particular command. But I'm already having OpenCV, so no need to install once again. So I think, guys, up to now we have cleared this, I hope. So at least you have a brief idea about what OpenCV, what are the applications we are having, and like what is an image and how we can work with an image. Now we'll see how to work with an image. So for that, what is a library we have to use? We have to use a library called OpenCV. So for that, how can I import my library with help of a command called import? So import, so what is the command? So we are having CV2. Even though whenever we are installing OpenCV-Python, but in importing, we have to use this statement called import CV2. Import CV2 means it will import your CV2 library. Now, if you just run this particular cell, you can see OpenCV is imported. So if you are not having this OpenCV, then it will throw an error. There is no module called CV2. Okay. So, but here I have already installed my OpenCV in my system. So whenever I'm importing import CV2, it will flow. So now if I want to check CV2 dot, you can see the version is now. Can anyone say what is the latest version of OpenCV? So actually it's 4.x, but can anyone guess what exactly the version? So actually there was a release in, some people say Hare Krishna, but can you see my screen? So what is a version I'm having? You are saying later version is 4.1.8, but already I'm having 4.2. So actually the latest version of OpenCV is 4.3.0. Yeah, exactly. Someone say exactly 4.3.0 is the latest version in the recently it has introduced. So 4.3. So 4.3 version is running. So as of now, I have installed my OpenCV. So my version is 4.2.0. Yes, many people are giving 4.3. Yes, 4.3 version is normally that is the latest version. So, but here you can see the my version. You can also check the version cv2.underscore_underscore version_underscore. If you mention that, it will just display your version. So I am having 4.2.0. Okay. So initially, first, what we will discuss is how we can able to read an image. Okay. So in terms of OpenCV, if you consider about OpenCV, right? So we are saying, right, if you are taking an image, our machine can see image in the terms of matrix or arrays, right? So here opens, whenever if you are reading an image with an OpenCV, it will read your image in terms of NumPy array. So now we'll just see that. So for that, in order to read the image, I need to have one image, right? So in my home folder, you can able to see test.jpg. Can you able to see test.jpg? So I'm having test.jpg in my home directory so that I can able to read that particular directory. So in order to read the image by using OpenCV, we are having a method called. So what is the method we are having? imread. With help of imread, we can able to read our particular image. So now we'll see an example for that. I'm just taking a variable called img is equals to nav. So here we want to call the method. So imread is an inbuilt method that is available in a CV2, right? So in order to call that imread, I have to call like this CV, because I have imported it like this, import CV2. So I need to call like this CV2.imread. So in that, so what I have to mention, so in that imread, it will take as one argument. So actually it will have a two default arguments. We'll see that. So it will take defaultly one argument. So what is that argument? Here in the parentheses, in the function, we have to pass the path of that particular image. Okay. So for example, if you are having an image in some other folder, okay. So if you are having in a main folder, which you are running your notebook, there is no need to give the entire path. Okay. So, but here itself in my home directory itself, wherever I'm running my code, in that code itself, I'm having my test.jpg. So that no need to give the entire path. So I can pass only the name of my image here. But whenever you are if you want to read your image from a different folders, then you have to give the entire path in this particular double quotes, right? So now we'll just see. So in Jupyter notebook, there is here if you click on the shift enter, it will automatically run that particular set. Now, so here we have read our image and we have stored our data in a variable called img. Now we want to see what is this img, right? So now if you take this img is a variable, right? So in the Python, if I want to know what is the data type of a particular variable, so what is a method? We are having some kind of inbuilt methods, right? So by using which method? We are having a method called type. With help of type, we can get the data type of that particular variable. So now I'm just checking type of img. So whenever I'm running my type of img, now you can able to see the screen, right? So it is saying, what it is saying, numpy.ndarray. ndarray stands for multidimensional array. So it is saying numpy multidimensional array. So now we'll just see what is img contain. Now I'm just printing. So here I'm using a Jupyter notebook, right? So no need to write a print statement compulsory. Okay. So it will all just print that. Now you can able to see this, right? 255. So here, can we able to see this? Here you can able to see the three dimension we have said, right? So colored image, when you take on a colored image, the colored image will be represented in a three dimensional array. Now you can able to see the dimensionality of this particular array, right? So if you type a particular variable dot ndim, then it automatically it will give you the dimensionality of that particular array. So here already we can able to see this by seeing this, we can able to say this is a three dimensional array. Now, whatever the image I have shown in the particular PPT, so that is the image I'm reading. So that is penguin image. So that is a colored image, right? So the colored image, it will be, I'm just loading the colored image so that it is having a three dimensional array. So in order to check what is the properties of this image, you can also see like what is the height and width. So here we are having a one more method called img.shape. So whenever I'm just printing img.shape, so it is giving, what it is giving? It is giving 395, 396 and the 3, right? So it is giving the height and width are height, width and the channels, right? So it is a colored image so that it will be taking as a three channels. So, and one more thing. So here in this, we have directly mentioned our image, right? Image name. So here actually it will have a two default parameters. It will take the two parameters. One is the path of the particular image and the other one is the mode. Okay. So default mode is one. So one stands for colored image. For example, I'm just taking one more variable called img1 equals to cv2.imread, right? So my name of my file is test.jpg. So if I'm just taking comma, I'll just mention zero. So here you will have a two things. One is zero and other one. Mostly used one is zero and one. Okay. So zero stands for it will take that as a, it will read that in a format of binary image. Okay. If you are giving a default value is a one, if you are giving or not giving the one, it will automatically take that as a one. Okay. So, but here I just want to read this image in terms of binary. Okay. Now we'll just see. Now we'll just check img dot shape. Now you can able to see the shape. Sorry, img1 dot shape. So now you can able to see, right? Yes, img1 dot shape. You can able to see only height and width parameters, right? So there is no channel. Like it is having a like grayscale image, it will have only one channel. When you are reading in terms of colored image, then only you will have a channel as a three. Now we'll also print that array. Now you can see. Now you can see the difference, right? So now here you can see the two-dimensional array. I told you, right? When you consider about a like grayscale image or a black and white image, it will be represented in a format of two-dimensional array. But when you consider a colored image, it will be represented in a format of 2D array. Now here you can able to see this, right? 255 255, because RGB values will be represented, right? So 255 255 255, what is the color code of, like, what is this color? 255 255 255, we have already seen white, right? So in my picture I'm having more of white, right? Yes, exactly, white. So here this particular entire thing element will be represented as a single pixel in a colored image. Now if you can see in the normal grayscale image, this 255 will be represented as a single pixel in this particular image. I hope now you people got understood, right? What is 2D two-dimensional array and what is three-dimensional array and how it will take the colors, right? I hope. So as of now, anyone is having doubt in this? Anyone have any kind of doubt? No, right? Yes. So now we'll just proceed to the next. Am I boring? No, right? Yes, thank you. So now we'll just continue. Practical session. So here, now we have seen, right? We have read our image. Now you see this, we are reading our image in terms of normal grayscale, right? So instead of that, yes, some person is asking how is OpenCV related to this image. So OpenCV, the main purpose of OpenCV is in order to work with images, in order to pre-process your images. Okay, so with help of OpenCV, how we can able to read a particular image and how can able to perform some kind of different pre-processing techniques to this image, we are going to discuss that. I hope you got an idea, right? It is named as Oppo. Now I think you have clear, right? So the main part of OpenCV is the work with images, and in order to, we are applying some kind of pre-processing techniques to this particular images. So how we can able to read, how we can able to show, how we can able to apply this. So that is we are going to deal with today. So now we have seen, right, how we can able to read the image. Now I just want to plot this particular image. I just want to show this particular image. Okay. So for that, we are having one more library that is called Matplotlib. I think you people know about Matplotlib, right? So here in Anaconda, again, it is an internal library. So I'm just loading that Matplotlib to plot my image in that particular graph. So actually, when you take this Matplotlib, we are having two different libraries. PyLab will be there, PyPlot will be there. I'm utilizing PyPlot. So I just want to plot this. I have given aliasing name to this matplotlib.pyplot because every time I can't call the methods like matplotlib.pyplot.some show, right? So that's the reason I have given a aliasing name for this matplotlib library. So especially the people who don't know about this matplotlib, in this deep learning thing and when it comes to this OpenCV, this matplotlib will be used for visualization of your data in a different plots, in a different graphical representation. We can represent this we can represent our data, and as well as also we can also represent our images. So now we are having a method called imshow in a matplotlib. So with that I am just plotting my image. So I'll just plot my normal img. Right. So now can you able to see that plt.imshow, I have plotted my colored image because I have read my colored image in a format of in a variable called img. Now, can you find any difference to the original image? So I'll show you the original image. I'll show you just now 2 minutes. I'll just show you my original image. Now, this is my original image. So, yes, this is my original image. In original image, I'm having a some kind of yellow, a black and white. Yes. Yes, and legs, why? So, I have someone given an answer, yes. Because I have mentioned, right, generally your images will be in terms of RGB colors, right? But when you consider about an OpenCV, it will be read your values in terms of like BGR, right? So it is represented in a format of BGR. Now, if I want to show you, if I want to plot my original image as it is, then I have to convert my BGR to RGB. Then only I can able to see my original particular original image. Now we'll see that. So in order to convert from my this OpenCV will take the BGR, right? So in order to convert from BGR to RGB, we are having a method called convert color. So CVT color is a method which will be used to convert your color from one type of color to other kind of color. So for that we are having a inbuilt method called convert color. So I'm just taking a new variable, some img2. So here we are having which method? cvt.cvtColor means convert color. So, and one more thing I just want to introduce people, like if you are using a Jupyter notebook, if you mention dot and if you mention tab, okay. So if you mention tab, so there you can able to see by using this OpenCV, we'll have an inbuilt methods, right? It will display what are the inbuilt methods we are having. So CVT. So now you can able to see, right? I got a convert color as a, like here you can able to see. So if you want to know more about that, in a Jupyter, we are having these kind of facilities. If you mention a particular library or particular variable dot, then if you press the tab button, then you can able to see the different methods that are available for that particular thing. Okay, so convert color. So in this convert color, it will take the two parameters. The first parameter is source, means here we have to pass our image. So where is our original image? It is having an img, right? So in that, next I have to use from which, like I need to mention the conversion method from where to where I want to convert. Okay, so for that, so I'm having a thing. So we'll have a convert color cv2 dot color cv2 dot color underscore. So I want to convert from where to where I want to convert from BGR to RGB, right? So I'm just converting BGR to RGB. So this is the way, in this way. So by using this CVT color, we can able to convert our image from from one type of end to other type of end. So here I'm just converting from BGR to RGB. Now we'll just plot this new image once again, and we'll see whether we are getting a original image or not. So here, what is my variable? My variable is IMG2. Now you can able to see, now you people can able to see the original image, right? So the original image which we are having. So with this convert color, you can also, we are having different things. So here you can convert from RGB, means a regular colored value, to black and white, and from black and white to color, and BGR to RGB. There are different kinds of methods will be there. You can explore later. So this is one kind of, I'm giving one kind of example for one method so that you can learn more about this. I think like you can able to start with these things. Okay. So here it will take, with the help of convert color, we can able to convert from BGR to RGB. Now you can able to see this, right? So here you can able to see this particular original image. So now we'll move into the next one. So and the next concept is, suppose here I have why I'm introducing this matplotlib means, so here in this matplotlib it will just plot your graph in terms of graph, right? Like you can see the numbers, right? Related numbers. So here we'll see one concept called ROI. I think you people know about this. What is ROI? What is ROI? Region of interest. So ROI stands for region of interest. So in this region of interest means we can able to get the portion from that particular image, right? So for example, so I just want to get only the some portion from my original image. So that is called ROI, region of interest, means from where to where I wanna take the particular portion, so that we can go with the ROI. So for that reason, I have plotted in this matplotlib. Now, you know Python language, right? So with help of indexing, we can able to get our ROI image. So I'm just taking the variable as a ROI. So where is our original image? So I'm just taking converted image. So that is IMG2. So you know slicing concept in a Python, right? So slicing from where to where I have to take. If I'm having some kind of values, for example, list string, so I can able to slice my data, right? So similar way here also you can able to print the portion of image with help of slicing. Now I just want to print only this particular head part. Okay, only I just want to print only the head part. Now just tell me from where I have to take. So what is my X value? So for slicing, I need to mention X value and as well as Y value. I have to mention the first, we have to mention Y value. So Y value, tell me from where to where I have to take. Just a guess. Now you can able to see the screen, right? So it is plotted in a graph. It is represented with the numbers, right? So now I just want to display only head part. So from where to where I have to take. Okay, some people are saying 0 to 200. Okay, we'll try with one by one. Okay, so some people are saying 0 to 150. Okay, some people are saying 0 to 150. And the next one, the Y value is completed. I have mentioned Y value. So what will be the X value for head? What will be the X value? 0 to 300? No, okay. So only head, see, remaining this empty portion I don't require, right? So now you can able to see something empty portion in this, like white thing I don't require. I need only head part. So can I start at 90 like that? Yes, 92. Okay, for your reference, I'm just taking as a 300. Okay, now. So now I'm just plotting this ROI. Now you will understood whether it is correct or not. So what is the method we are using? IM show. With the help of IM show, we can able to plot this ROI. So now you can able to see, right? So now again, we have to change some kind of thing. Like we have to modify some kind of slicing here so that you can able to get only the particular head here. So if you look at here, nose is missing, right? So that particular nose is missing, right? Now you can also extend this. We have taken from 0 to 150, right? So some people mentioned 0 to 200. Now we'll see what will happen if we take to 200. 0 to 200. So 0 to 200. So now again, I have to run this. Now it is good. Mostly it's perfect. So if I'm taking from 0 to 200 or 20 to 200, and if I'm taking from 90 to 300, I can able to get only the portion. So, and in the same way, you can also represent only this nose also. So like that, whenever you have required some kind of, you have to get only the portion, only you have to get a sub portion from your entire image, then you can go with this ROI concept, region of interest, with the help of this particular pixel range. Then you can able to, yes, you can try that. You'll get the perfect values. So it's a trial and error method because we have to check these particular things, right? So for that, you can able to see the particular values, and you can able to print so that you can able to get the proper values. So in this way, we can also get a portion of image from the particular entire whole image. That is concept is called as ROI. So yeah, I got some kind of responses. I understood, right? Now you got the point. So with help of this, we can able to get only. So we are talking about nose, right? We can able to get only nose, and we can also get only eyes also. We can able to print only eyes or else only legs. So based on the particular values, we can able to represent that. We can able to slice that, and we can able to represent that only a ROI image from the entire image. So this is also one of the concept of your images to deal with the images, that is getting a portion of thing from the entire image. So that concept is called as ROI. So I hope you understood this. Now, can we have a break for 5 minutes so that we'll continue? So is it okay? We'll have a 5 minutes of break. Then we'll just continue with other kind of techniques. Yeah. then only you will understood. Now we'll just display this. So how we can able to display that? We are having cv2.imshow. Okay, so here we'll take this cv2.imshow. Okay, so here I'll just show you a normal image and as well as edge image. Okay, so this is my edge image. Okay, so and I have to use a weight key. Okay, now we'll see how you can able to see an edge detection in this particular image. Now I'll just share the screen once again. Wait a minute. Yes, can you able to see that edge detection image? Everyone can able to see this edge detection. Can you see, like, once I have applied an edge detection to this particular image, now you can able to see only the edge values in that particular image, right? See, it is applying some kind of edge line. So however, it is taking that as a proper line and the proper shape, that particular one. So it will apply the edge to that particular image. So this is a one kind of, again, one kind of pre-processing techniques that is also available in your OpenCV. And the similar way we can also have a different kinds of thing. See, here we have mentioned 100, 200, right? So now you can change that particular lower threshold and upper threshold, and you can see the difference. Okay, so, and this is also one of the technique. So now, so as we are having other, we are having different kinds of techniques, and also we can able to resize our image. So for that, we are having an inbuilt method called resize. So with the help of that resize, we can able to change our height and width of our image. So that is a simple one, so that I'm not discussing about that. So we are just a simple inbuilt command called cv2.resize. So that will resize your particular frame. Okay, so as of now, we are still discussing about you can see the resize code. So here you can see cv2.resize. Okay, so there we have to pass the parameters. One is a source, okay, and the other one is we have to pass the height and width of the particular one. So here I'm just changing to, for example, 250, comma something 340. Okay, now I'm just changing this particular height and width. So now I'll just plot this in a matplotlib so that you can able to see the difference. So plt.imshow. So this particular img. Okay. Now you can able to see. So we'll just check the shape of that one, img3.shape. Now you can able to see the difference, right? So now in this picture, you can able to see the difference, right? So here the values will be different and here your range will be different. Okay, so our image will be resized with the help of an inbuilt method called resize. So img.shape, if you mention the shape, then it will be changed to our dimensions 340, 250 and 3. Why 3 means it is a colored image. So similar way, as of now, you are working with only images, right? So now I'll just tell you one more concept, like how we can able to go for a streaming. How can, by using OpenCV, how we can able to get an, how we can able to go for a video streaming. So for that, we are having a method called video capture in a OpenCV in order to go for a streaming. So if you comes to, like, I'll just write a simple command so that you will understood. So video is equals to, we are having a method called cv2.video. I'll answer your all questions. Please be patient for that. So here in this video capture, we can have a different kinds of parameters. So mostly we'll have a three parameters. What are those means here? Suppose in this video video capture, you want to go for a streaming of you. You want to show for a, you want to show a particular video which is already you are having, so that you can also pass the path of the here. You can also here you have to sorry. So here in this particular method, you have to pass the path of video. Okay. So for that displaying, you can use here. So the one way is, so if you are mentioning, you can mention path of video. So this video capture will be going for streaming that particular thing, whether it may be a live video streaming or whether it may be a like if you are having a video that will also stream that particular video. Okay. So one thing is you can able to give the path. And other thing is, if you are giving a zero, okay. So if you are mentioning zero, it will take as a live streaming. Okay. So if you are giving a zero, then it will take that as a live video streaming. Okay. So for example, you are running this particular, you are running the code in this particular laptop or in your system itself. Suppose if you are using desktop, if I'm using laptop here with the help of zero, my laptop will have a internal camera, inbuilt camera will be there, right? So from automatically it will take the streaming from that. For example, if I'm using for the desktop, I don't have a camera for that, right? So I can able to connect an external camera, right? So in order to connect an external camera, you can use a parameter as one for external camera. Okay, if you are connecting external camera to your system, then you have to mention the parameter as a one. If you can have a three kind of options. One is you can pass the path of video. Other one is if you can put the zero means it will go for a live streaming. And other one is external camera. So you can also go for an external camera. So in this video capture, we are creating a just a instance for the video capture. Now we have to read the images. So now if you consider about this, so when you're talking about images, what we are saying, image is nothing but group of pixels. Now what is a video? Video is nothing but your group of images, right? The group of images which is running very fastly. So that is your video, right? Video is nothing but your group of collection of images or group of your frames. Frame is nothing but your image. Okay. So for that, we have to read the particular image. In order to read the image, we are having a method called, so I'll just tell you what is this variables. Okay. So we are having a method called, what is our variable? Video, right? So video dot read. We are having a parameter called, we are having a method called video dot read. With help of video dot read, we can able to get the single frame from that particular streaming. So it may be live or it may be from the video. Okay. So this, whenever I'm just taking this particular video read, so it will just give you the two parameters. Okay. So it will just return the two parameters. You can see I have written one is data and other one is frame, right? So what is this data? So actually it will give you the first value, the data. It will give you the first value as a Boolean value. Means there is an yes or no. For example, if you can able to get your frame perfectly, then your data value will become one. So, and if you are unable to get the frame, then your data value become zero. So then we are having one more parameter called frame, right? So frame is nothing but whatever the image you are getting from that streaming, that will be stored in a variable called frame. Okay. So now we'll just show you, we'll just display that particular frame. So with help of what is again cv2.imshow. So the CV2, like this OpenCV will be concept of this only. You'll have n number of like these things only. Every time you have to use this imshow, imread and these things. So for this, and now I'm just passing. So here I have to pass the variable called frame. Okay. So now what is the thing I have to use? I have to use my wait key, right? So for that, I'm just writing a condition here for the frame. So normally I'm just closing with a manual close symbol, right? So instead of that here, I'll just write the code for like if I'm pressing any kind of keyboard like value, then I can able to close my, I can able to stop this processing stream. So for that, I am writing a simple condition here. So I'll just answer your all queries. Please be patient. So and I'm just writing a condition. You know, this is for zero. This will be a mask for your values like keyboard arguments. Okay. So now I'm just taking a variable called Q. Whenever if I'm pressing a Q, then it has to stop. So here in order to stop that, I'm just using a break. Okay. So then, so it has in order to release. So whenever if I'm using a like video streaming or any video from here, so if I want to stop that, then I have to stop the video. So there is a method called video dot release. With the help of that video dot release, we can able to stop that video streaming. So then here we are opening IM show window, right? So I just want to close that even that window also. So for that, I'm just using a method called destroy all windows. Okay, so A is capital. And W is also capital. Okay, so this, so cv2.destroy all windows. So now we'll just see one. So see here, I'm just running my video streaming. It will open the video and it will capture me and you can able to see that particular image. So we'll just see that. Sorry. Sorry for that. I have struck, my window has struck. Just wait for 2 minutes. I'll share my screen. So my window got struck. Sorry for that. Just give me 2 minutes. It's not responding. Give me 2 minutes. I'm just trying that. Sorry guys, my window was struck, so it has kernel has dead. So and I'm just running my this code once again. So now I'll just start my kernel. Okay, so you know this like people who are already having a knowledge on this kernel. So my kernel has dead. So like I'm continuously using this, right? So whenever kernel is there, suppose now just see, I'm just running this CV2. What it is saying, name CV2 is not defined because it will lose all this kernel values. Okay. So now I have run that particular CV2. Now I'm just running this video code. So I'm just running this video code. I'll just window. Please don't mind. I don't have a proper visibility. Now, can you able to see the like screen, right? So now you can see, actually I'm moving something, but can you able to see the difference? Like here, I can able to see only the particular first image, right? So for that, what may be the reason? Can you tell me? Like you people, can you tell me, like here I can able to see only the particular screen, right? So yeah, someone said that is correct. So not wait key, I'm using that. So what is the one more thing? Someone has given the right answer, but I'm just waiting for some more people. So this will be like, why? Because I'll just tell you, because here one person said that is Hare Krishna. You are absolutely correct because we are not using any for loop. Okay. So why? Because here we are not using any for loop. So that's the reason it is not showing the entire thing. So for that, I have already written a code for that. So I'll just tell you, I'll just show you that. And also I'll just show you. Okay, I'm just taking this and I'm showing this IM show window. So now we'll see. So if I'm pressing Q, then only it will start my stream. Okay, now it will launch the window. So actually I have written a code for video writing also. So for that, now can you able to see that whenever, now it is record, like it is displaying my streaming. Now you can able to see, right? I am moving. So, right. So that's the reason, like here we are missing a for loop in the above code. So I have not written a while loop. So whenever we are using while loop means it is always continuously, like I'm just stopping this. So if I'm just pressing the Q symbol, it will stop. If I'm using while true means that condition is always satisfied, right? So in this way, so here I'm just taking a capturing of zero and I'm just displaying the image, like frame, whatever I'm getting from this particular video in a IM show. So, and we'll just close up in a 2 minutes. So we'll have a, like, I'll just tell you one more thing here. In order to save your images, we have seen up to only how to, can we read an image, how can we write, how can we show an image, right? In order to save that particular image to your system, we are having a method called cv2.im, right? So with help of cv2.im, right? So we can able to save our image. So here you have to pass the name of the name which in which you want to save the particular image. And here you have to pass a frame. Okay, so here while true, and here we are having data comma frame, then here it will save that particular IM, right? So in the similar way, here we are taking continuous streaming, right? It may be from here in place of zero, you can go for a path. So if you mention the path, it will take the video from that particular like MP4. You can able to take MP4, AVI, different formats will be there, right? For video, you can pass the particular video files here. So then you can able to read the particular frame, that particular image, then you can able to display, and as well as you can able to save that particular image. Okay. So, and finally, I just want to show you one thing. Last thing, it won't take much time. Just give me a 2 minutes. I think you have already know this, but I just want to show you this. Give me 2 minutes of time. So please don't mind, I'm taking your too much of time, right? So now I'll just run this code. Now just see what happened. So now can you able to see the screen? So actually this is a face detection code. So with help of HAAR cascade classifiers, means HAAR, HAAR means we are having some kind of features like edge features, line feature. So now can you able to see that I am only having in my role, so that it is detecting, you can see number of faces detected one, and it is detecting my face features and it is detecting my eye features. You can able to see it, right? So here, this is a like this is a simple code which is there in the like OpenCV. With help of HAAR cascade classifiers, we can able to use you can able to run this code, and you will it will detect the number of faces in the particular video stream. Then it will detect the number of faces. Suppose if the two people are there, it will have a two people. It will show you. It will show you the particular two people window. So now. So Jay, are you sorry, Vishnu, are you there?
Yeah, Swati.
Yeah, actually I'm taking a little bit. I just want to convey some more information to these people, but because of this time constraint, I could able to cover. So sorry guys, I hope you have learned something about this OpenCV. I hope you have learned little bit about this OpenCV. Thank you guys. Thank you so much. Now I'll just Vishnu will take that.
Yeah. Have you answered the Q&As as well?
No, I have to check that.
Okay. Please. Before answering Q&A, guys, I'm going to share a poll feedback. So I just launched the poll. Let me know if you can see the poll. Please mention in the comments, in the chat. Okay. So Swati, in the meantime, you can take their questions and answer them.
Yes, I'll answer those questions.
Guys, some please, of I the people everyone have... to fill the feedback. You can start taking questions, Swati, in the Q&A.
Yeah, I am just taking.
Okay. In the meantime, guys, please fill the poll. I can see more half of you are yet to fill the poll. Swati, if you can stop sharing your screen and share.
Yeah, fine.
Or you can open, okay, anyway, do anything. I'll just share.
I'll stop the sharing of my screen. Give me 1 minute.
Okay, a few more people to go, please fill the form. Okay, quickly, I think in the meantime that you're filling the form before Swati answering, I think it's during a time. I just quickly want to present you this remote summer internship program that is available for most of the students. I can see that they want to join a remote internship program right now and make the most of the time. As you can see, the lockdown also has been extended and there's a lot of time for you guys to make the most of this situation and keep learning. So give me 1 second. Yeah, just let me know if you can see the web page. Are you able to see my screen and my voice audible? You can just type it in the chat. Okay, that's great. Yeah. So guys, we introduce you the Remote Summer Internship Program 2020. Our summer internship program is India's largest summer internship program because we've done in the last year for more than 3,000 students across 280 colleges. We've partnered with more than 35 companies. I crossed 15 venues pan India on 4 technologies last year. So that was the numbers of last year. And one predominant change to last year and this year is it was predominantly physically like offline driven last year. But this year, as you can see with the situation, as well as even we've thought even before the whole breakdown and the outbreak has happened, we launched this remote summer internship program well before that. And one more thing that you can see here is we've been IBM EdTech partners for more than 2 years now. So even the summer internship program is in collaboration with IBM. We're also nominated as VMware Regional IT Academy in 2019. And this year we've collaborated with IUCE, as you can see, Indo-University Collaboration for Engineering Education. It is similar to IEEE. Most of you, I think, have heard about IUCE publications, journals, and other things. So one good thing is this program is right now open for global audience, and you can learn a lot. Coming to the technology tracks that we're offering, artificial intelligence, machine learning, robotic software developer, blockchain developer, cybersecurity, cloud app developer. So if you're interested in OpenCV and anything about image processing and all, I think artificial intelligence would be the right track for you guys to join. And the main features that are different, that makes a clear difference in the market is, it is a pure online instructor-led training program. That means not like any recorded video series where you pay and you just see the videos and learn, no. So we have a live instructor-led training program, and we have this beautiful platform that's called Smart Practice School platform. So we've integrated the Smart Practice School platform with GitHub, Slack, Repo, Zoho Writer, and there are guided labs also. That means there's a clear project template which has been structured for you guys to make your understanding and practice as easy as possible. And also, you should understand one thing, you will also get a company-like environment in a practice school. So what we are doing is, so even companies can register on the platform, and they are the ones who are going to formulate the structure of the project, okay? So typically, every team member, like in the project development phase, you'll be formed into teams. So individually, there will be a assignment, or there'll be assigned tasks. So say suppose there's a project A, and it has 3 to 4 tasks, like data pre-processing, data extraction, or data collection. Now, it is not that most of the cases, they'll be forming a team of 2 or 3 members, and 80% or 70% work will be done by one guy, reporting will be done by other and all. So in this, you can clearly divide the work and also monitor it from the company side, as well as from the college side as well. So there's a clear demo also will happen. So this, what we're trying to do here is to give you this company-like environment. So we've done this with the help of integration of AgileBot. So people, I think the faculty here or the industry professionals in the webinar can understand agile development, that's what we're trying to do. So I think I can give a more clear demo. We can plan for a more clear demo for the total platform on the remote summer internship program. If you're interested, I'm going to leave my my email ID in the chat. So any faculty out there who are interested for the demo and want a remote summer internship for your college students, please contact me. Yeah, I just left my mail ID, and I'm also giving my phone number as well. Yeah, and also there are phone numbers in the website as well. But one more point of information, we also started this remote summer internship program for Good Level Engineering College right now for 300 students. And we are also planning for ECE, civil, mechanical branches as well. GNITS is the next college. Sona, there is one in Tamil Nadu, which we are starting. So those are the colleges that we are doing right now. Okay, so what are the takeaways from this whole program? So you'll be getting a training completion certificate. You'll be getting an internship letter. You'll be getting a project completion letter, as well as you'll be getting IBM skill badges throughout this program. And there's a beautiful chance for you to work with the global team. So when I told we are open for global audience, that is true, because we are getting applications from Saudi Arabia, Singapore, Egypt, USA, Malaysia, all around the world. So this, at this point of view, when you register as individual, you'll be formed new teams with different people with different regional and nationalities. Can either be with from Mumbai or Delhi or Bangalore, or even from out of country also. So it also indirectly improves your team communication skills and personality development as well. So that is the one thing. And the platform, you can also generate your resume dynamically. So people should understand one thing in the platform. So whatever course, now let's say you take an artificial intelligence, right? So you, then there'll be Python for data science as first, then artificial intelligence course. So every topic, there's a skill tag. So this skill tag can be generated online and can be shared online as well. So these all skill tags add to your resume dynamically. So that's where this platform is driving such innovation, because once the project completion letter that you'll be getting at the end, the certificate, it's everything online shareable. It is just an open source link where you can share it with any recruiter, any higher studies, master's school, or be it anywhere. You can share it or also add to your LinkedIn profiles. So that is the key benefits of the program. And there are three different categories of how we are organizing the summer internship program. If you feel that you already have enough knowledge and skill set that you can just need help to do any project templates and access the platform that I've been telling, then we have the Career Basic program, which is for free of cost. Then if you need any mentorship and crash course, then you can offer a Career Plus program. Then we also have Career Pro, which starts from the basic scratch of the whole technology. It is for a 1 month long program, and you'll be getting 3 month access to the whole platform. As you can see, the like benefits and the characteristics of each program written in the website. Don't worry, I'm going to share the website and other posters and information with you all in your mails. So you can get back to me if you need any demo, or if you're planning any remote internship programs for your respective colleges, please call back. And this point, I think that's it from my end. I'll do drop in this website in the chat box. In the meantime, you can check it out. So Swati, over to you. You can take the further questions. Swati?
Yeah, actually, I have answered all the questions, Vishnu. Like people are again asking. Like if the people are having any kind of doubts, so that I can.
I hope you got individual answers. Swati has answered in the Q&A.
Yes. Forum. Yes.
Yeah. So, guys, if there are any other doubts, please put in. Or else, I think we can wrap the session. Akhil, if you're there, Vidya, sir.
So, and also I'm just giving my mail ID. So yeah, if you're having any kind of doubts in this session, or like if you are having any kind of doubts in AI and also, you can also contact me. So some people are asking, so that I'm just giving in a normal mail. So this is my mail ID. So you can contact me this through this mail ID.
Yeah, that's wonderful, Swati. Thank you.
Yeah.
Sagar sir, you are telling something? Thank you, guys. I hope you enjoyed the session, and I hope it has opened a lot of information gathering for you people and start your technology.
Hi, Vishnu. Can you hear me? So the for the people who are like still worrying how to get to the answers, like I'll just share an invite link for the chat for the WhatsApp. I mean, if they want to directly join, they can join. I'm just sharing here in the. So you can join there and you can introduce yourself and you can directly ask questions there. I mean, it was like fantastic session right now. I didn't expect this much deep it would be. And I hope like all the IEEE guys, folks there who are in this session, like have been into this and, you know, got to know some key points of the computer vision. And thank you, Swati Garu and Vishnu for
thank you so much
for this session. Yeah, soon we'll be having a lot more similar kind of that. And I hope people would like to come again and again. Yeah.
And thank you, guys. Thank you so much for your patience. I think it's already 1:30, right? And actually, I want to convey some more information for you. But due to the time constraint, I have conveyed only this to you. So you can go for researching of that and you can learn more things. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much for your patience.
Thank you, guys.
This presentation recording would be shared to your emails. We'll be uploading in the YouTube and be sharing you. Don't worry. And people, if you like what you saw today, you can do it on your own. And this can be done through our internship program. So please give it a thought. And you can also show this as a project. And maybe with the mentor support, you can make it a major project as well. So do check it out.
Vishnu, it was like the best platform, I would say, for the students out there, for the young grads who are like interested to do projects in AI and other stuff in emerging technologies. Like SmartBridge is a way and is one of the easiest process for them to engage with the projects rather than just go ahead as a herd or something. And it would be a better opportunity for them. And please put up the mails for us as well for all the IEEE guys. For the internship programs and all. Thank you, Vishnu. Thank you.
Sure. Definitely. Definitely, guys. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I hereby conclude this webinar on computer vision, and I thank you, IEEE CS chapter, for organizing this and for all the students and the participants who have attended on this Sunday. And thank you, Swati, for taking time out of your holiday and giving us this valuable session.
Yes.
And I hope everyone will meet in some other platform or SmartBridge programs. I wish you all the best and hope you'll keeping improving a technological curve. Thank you. This is Vishnu.
Yes. All the best, guys.
Thank you.